Okay. Well, hello, everybody. Thanks for coming out tonight. My name's Mark, and I'm going to talk to you all about the classic TV show, The Twilight Zone. Okay, so right away, my title slide, I have a question for you all. Does anybody recognize what episode this is taken from? You do?
It's on the guy with the glasses. His glasses broke.
You know what? I'm going to give it, it's not the episode, but I'm going to give you credit for it because that scene was used in that episode, was used in two episodes. It was used in two episodes, Time Enough at Last, and this episode, Nice Place to Visit. This is actually taken from Nice Place to Visit. When it was used in Time Enough at Last, it was the setup for the public library. Those were the stairs on the public library. It didn't have the Hall of Records sign. That was specific to this episode. But when it was used in Time Enough at Last, it was the public library. And actually, this actor here, this is Sebastian Cabot. That name ring any bells, anybody? Okay, so in this particular episode, he had to play sort of this angelic angel-type figure. Well, you know, minus the twist at the end. And he had jet black hair, jet black facial hair, and it was sort of a big thing for him to get him to actually dye his hair white for the show. It was a big thing. It was not easy, but he eventually did it. And of course, by the way, there's going to be spoilers. So if you have not seen any of these episodes, what are you doing? You got to go see it. It's the best show ever. But there will be some spoilers. Spoiler alert for this episode, he was not an angel, but essentially, I guess, a devil. So let's get rolling. Okay. So whenever you do a presentation, I was always told, start with a quote, start with a joke, start with an anecdote. So I decided to start with a quote. Unfortunately, I had over 150 episodes worth of Twilight Zone material to pick a good quote from. And I chose this one. From The Masks, a season 5 episode. Actually, the only episode directed by a female. Ida Lupino directed this episode. And she actually appeared in a season 1 episode on the 16mm Shrine, season 1 episode. It was actually Rod Serling's, it was one of his least favorite episodes in retrospect, because basically what he was saying is, so the main character, Ida Lupino, throughout the whole episode, she's just, I'm getting old, I want to be young again so I could be a really good actress, because I used to be, and all of a sudden she gets rewarded, and she gets transported back into the movies where she's young again, and Rod Serling didn't like that. There was no moral there, there was no lesson, so he wasn't a fan of that particular episode, but Ida Lupino directed this episode of The Masks, and it is regarded as one of the best, and I'm going to agree with that. Basically, you have this old guy, he's on his deathbed, and his greedy descendants show up, and they're waiting for him to die, and they're waiting for him. They cannot wait for him to die so they can inherit his money. And he makes them wear these masks. And when he does that, they take off the mask, and their faces are just completely distorted, and they're all ugly. As ugly on the outside as they are on the inside. It's a really, really well-done episode, and she directed it. But this particular quote, I think, is going to get at the heart of what I want to talk about in this presentation. It's Wilfred is one of the characters. And this is the old gentleman there talking to his greedy descendants. Wolf responds to things that, I'm going to read it just in case you can't, it might be tough to see. He responds to things that have weight and bulk and value. He feels books. He doesn't read them. So I want you to think about, as I'm going through the talk, the content of the books, the knowledge they contain, not just the books themselves. But before we get there, I want to do two things tonight. I want to split the lecture in half. I want to give a little bit of history on The Twilight Zone, maybe pull out a few episodes here and there, share a few tidbits, little trivia that I think is interesting. And then I'm going to get to the heart of the lecture, talking about the episodes that deal with knowledge. Some books, maybe some non-books, because not all knowledge is contained within books. So I'm going to branch out a little bit, and I'm going to capture a whole host of things. So we're going to get right into it. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone. I think it was the perfect slide. So in total of 5 seasons, running from 59 to 64, there are 156 total episodes. Rod Serling, the creator, was responsible for writing scripts for 92 of them. Now, if you add in 2 other writers, Robert Matheson and Charles Beaumont, you're talking 128 episodes out of the 156. So it's really a big 3 in terms of writers. Richard Matheson is a name you may not recognize as a writer, but you ever see the movie Duel? He wrote that movie. So he is actually someone who has written sci-fi for a long time. Charles Beaumont, I'll get to a little bit later. But that's really those are really the big 3 for writers. All right, I want to talk about this 1958 episode. I know I said, and I have my slide doesn't lie, season 1 started in 1959. This particular episode, the time element, debuted on, it was Desi Lu's Playhouse. Anybody remember that? Yeah? Yeah, okay. So Desi Arnaz actually introduced this particular episode, the time element, because they were looking for some filler to fill the episode. And they found a Rod Serling script, and they said, wow, Rod, he's a pretty established writer. He's good. We're just going to play it. And it was unlike anything that really ever aired on TV at that particular time. I mean, you look at some of the TV shows. I mean, you know, you have Dick Van Dyke, Leave It to Beaver, Donna Reed. I mean, these are sitcoms. Twilight Zone is not a sitcom. I know you didn't come here to hear me say that, but it is not a sitcom. Spoiler alert. Like I said, there are spoilers tonight. Basically, the story is, you can see right here, it airs very infrequently. It's aired about, I think, twice since Twilight Zone was sold to syndication. You have a psychiatrist and a patient, and the patient, he has these vivid dreams every night that he's at Pearl Harbor, and he has to warn people about Pearl Harbor. It's his duty to warn people about Pearl Harbor, and he wakes up, and it's just a dream, but it's so real. And the psychiatrist is trying to tell him, these are just dreams, don't worry about it, they're just dreams. Then eventually, he has a dream that is so vivid, he actually ends up dying in Pearl Harbor, okay? The next scene is a psychiatrist's office completely empty. And the psychiatrist goes to get a drink afterwards. He goes to the bar, and he sees a picture on the wall of the bar. And it's a picture of the man, the patient, who had these vivid dreams. And he says to the bartender, what's that picture for? He said, oh, that was a regular who came in here for years. But unfortunately, he was in Pearl Harbor, and he died. So you have a real sort of twist there. And this did not take place, the episode did not take place during World War II. It took place in 1958. So there was a real twist there. That really established Twilight Zone's knack for twist endings and that element there. So before I get into season one, I want to talk a little bit about Rod Serling. Rod Serling decided sci-fi was the way to go. And the reason he came to that was because he hated being censored about his writing. And the number one entity that would censor him, two entities really, sponsors and the networks. Rod Serling's original choice for a pilot episode was titled The Happy Place, and he wrote this himself. It's about a society that when you got to a certain age, I'm not going to tell you the age, when you got to a certain age, you were deemed unuseful and you were eliminated, for lack of a better word. He pitched that. He was really excited about it. CBS Network said, no. That is not going to happen. Find another story. He said, oh, fine. So he did. Another thing during his writing, sponsors had a big say in what you could or could not say, and he did not like that one bit. So in order to sort of get her, he also couldn't comment on current events. So let's say, for example, this actually happened. He wrote a script, Requiem for a Heavyweight, before he did Twilight Zone. And he wanted to have a debate going between two, I believe, senators. And all of that dialogue was nixed. He was not allowed to talk about anything that was real world, could be construed as real world politics. And he didn't like that because he wasn't making any statement. He wanted to have a realistic conversation between two political figures who he wasn't making any statement. But the network said, no, that could be construed as political, not going to happen. Okay, fine. If Rod Serling decides to write a science fiction script where the setting is something in the future or a different society, and he makes any kind of commentary he wants, and someone says you can't, he said, what are you talking about? This is science fiction. I'm not making any kind of comments like that at all. So that was his workaround. And a lot of his themes really played into that. So I've highlighted a few season one episodes, basically just the ones that I could fit on the screen. But I have some tidbits here. This is the first episode, Where Is Everybody?, that aired on October 2nd, 1959, that got the whole series started. The original narrator that Rod Serling wanted for the series was actually Orson Welles. That is who he wanted. He did not get Orson Welles. He was busy. So instead, he settled on a man named Westbrook Van Voorhis, who I am not familiar with, but apparently he did voiceovers for shows and everything sort of like that back in the day. And he was the original voiceover. He did the intro and the ending that we're all familiar with. When the episode was really got good success, Westbrook Van Voorhis couldn't do other episodes, so Rod Serling stepped in and he redubbed the first episode just for consistency. So that's why you have Rod Serling doing the narrations. In season one, he did not appear on screen at all. That's how you can tell a season one episode. It's like, because the intro, he is not on the screen, it's just his voice. I'm going to get into what happened there in a little bit, because there's actually a really cool reason why it happened that way. So basically, right here, And where is everybody? It's a story about a man. He's in a town. He doesn't know where anybody is. He's the only person in the town. Nobody's around. He has no idea why. It turns out he was actually put in solitary confinement because he's training to go to the moon. And look at the date, 1959. We haven't been to the moon yet. But he's training for the real mental rigors of what it would take to be alone on such a trip. Rod Serling, years later, was a little unhappy with the ending because there really wasn't any sci-fi element to it. So what he did when he wrote a novelization for it was he included a little extra that was not in the original episode. He included that a theater ticket be found in the gentleman's pocket as he's being taken away at the end. And that makes sense in the story because in the story he does actually visit a theater. So that's not in the episode. That wasn't written in the episode, but it's in the novelization Rod Serling threw in because he thought it would fit a little bit better with a nice little twist and sci-fi element to it. Next, I want to talk about this one right here. This episode is called Walking Distance. So Gig Young was actually the actor in this episode, the main actor, and he was paid a lot of money, as was Edwin in a season two episode. Rod Serling paid his actors a lot of money. The network went to him and said, Rod, you're paying your actors way more than what the network typically pays actors. You're going to go severely over budget real fast if you do that. And the network's kind of already on you because you think about it. Other shows at the time, and I mentioned the sitcoms, they basically have one setting. You know, you have your apartment setting. It wasn't really expensive, all things considered. Twilight Zone, different settings, different for every episode. It's an anthology. So it racked up the budget really fast. And some of the network heads were kind of on him about that from the start. So Rod Serling kind of got some good advice. Watch your budget. You're paying your actors way too much. So Gig Young was the highest paid actor for any Twilight Zone episode because no one has spoken to Rod Serling at the time. CBS. Okay, yes. Yep, CBS. Yep. Friday nights, except for one season when it was on Thursday, but we'll get to that. Yeah. Yes. Absolutely. You know what? I had that number, but I don't remember the exact number at that time. I have other numbers for later things I'm going to talk about. Well, it was a lot of all things considered. I mean, at that, whatever it was in 1959 was considered a lot for an actor. I have other numbers. I could not find the number. I found it once. For the life of me, I could not find that number again. I'm sure if I did a lot more digging, maybe I could find it. Maybe the next Twilight Zone talk, I'll have that number. So, you know what? I promise you, the next Twilight Zone talk, I'm going to have that number. But anyway, this episode is notable for a couple reasons. One, it marks the very first on. This is not what I'm talking of. Ron Howard. This is not Ron Howard, but Ron Howard does appear in this episode. It's his very first screen credit. Pretty cool. And Rod Serling, looking back, was not a particular fan of this one. In he said, you know, the story's okay, but I think this one here, A Stop at Willoughby, is a very similar story. But I like A Stop at Willoughby better because he liked the ending. He liked zingers. Rod Serling's daughter, in a 2019 interview, sort of stepped back a lot on what Rod Serling had to say about Walking Distance. And she said that Rod Serling had a lot of sentimental value with this particular episode because he based it on his own life, and that the place that Gig Young goes to relive his childhood is based on Rod Serling's childhood town. It had the gazebo, had the merry-go-round. Everything in there was based on Rod Serling's childhood. So he was very nostalgic about it. So I get the sense in hearing that interview by Rod Serling's daughter that he had such a high regard for that episode. He personally held himself to such a high standard, he didn't feel he delivered as well. That's just a thought. Rod Serling's not here to actually say that. But I believe that's what's going on there. This episode right here, What You Need, is the only episode in Twilight Zone to have ever aired on Christmas Day. So this is the most Christmas episode of the entire series. They did two other Christmas, Rod Serling, two other Christmas episodes in season two and season three, Night of the Meek and Five Characters in Search of an Exit, which are Christmas themed. This one's not really Christmas themed, but it is if you think about it. So basically, this particular gentleman here can see the future, and he goes around giving everybody what they need. For example, there's the opening scene. There's an old washed-up baseball player, you know, who can't play ball anymore. But he gives, here, you're gonna need this bus ticket. A bus ticket? I'm not going to anywhere near there. Trust me, it's what you need. He gets a phone call from payphone. I love it, payphone, and says, we want to hire you to be a coach. Can you be on a bus to that particular city right away? And he's, yes, I can. So he would do that sort of thing. But this gentleman right here, Mr. Renard, in the actual show, sees basically a gravy train, and he wants that for himself. He gets him to give him a leaky pen that can, when it drops on newspaper, it sees all the horse results winners, so he bets on that, and he gets money on it. And actually, the newspaper they use is the same newspaper used in Time Enough at Last that says, you know, world on the edge of nuclear war, watch out. So if you look real closely, when he opens that newspaper, it says, the world's doomed, nuclear war is coming. But he just goes right past it and goes right to the horse races. So, I mean, Mr. Renard can't be too concerned about nuclear war, I guess. So it's a Twilight Zone episode, but it's a nice, it's Christmas themed, that it's a gift-giving sort of episode. This particular episode here is The Lonely. And what's significant about this episode, it was filmed on location in Death Valley. One of three episodes to do so. The others are season two episodes, Rip Van Winkle Caper and 100 Yards Over the Rim. I'm pointing this episode out, because the actors and the crew weren't prepared for the intense heat of Death Valley. They suffered heat stroke, dehydration. It was not pleasant for them. They weren't prepared for that. But they got through, and they made the necessary preparations for when they filmed on site in a climate like, in an environment like that in the future. This particular episode, Willoughby, goes, I have this on here just to draw a contrast with Walking Distance. Rod Serling liked the ending for this one much, much, much better. There was a really good zinger with Willoughby getting off from the town of Willoughby is actually the funeral company Willoughby. So by getting off the train, the man actually jumped out of the train. It's a really nice episode with a really good zinger. This episode here, right here, Judgment Night. I mentioned that Rod Serling did not like to be censored. This was the first episode in the first season, about 10 or so episodes in. I think it was the 10th episode. I think it was the 10th, where they came up with a censorship issue filed by the sponsor. Rod Serling, so this takes place on an English vessel. Rod Serling felt it perfectly acceptable that on an English vessel, you have a spot of tea, you have a tray of tea. But the sponsors didn't sell tea, they sold coffee. So they made him change that. And he said, okay, I don't want to do that. So he said, we'll just bring you a tray. And that was that. And reading an interview that Rod Serling gave about this, he said, it was the only issue we've had so far. That's okay, not a big deal. His tune would soon change in later seasons because he really got tired of that censorship fiasco. But he was okay because it happened. It was the first time it happened. Okay, not a big deal. We'll move on. It was a sort of a harbinger of things to come for him. And this episode here, When the Sky Was Open, talking about three astronauts who go up, and they come down, but then they suddenly disappear because the universe, they weren't supposed to make it back, but somehow they did. And the universe is trying to make it right, almost like a final destination sort of thing. And they would disappear. Rod Serling wrote the screenplay for this. So this is a Rod Serling credit, but it was based on a short story by Matheson. Okay, and Rod Serling was so impressed with how the story came out, he immediately hired Matheson to become a writer on the show. So if not for this, Matheson does not become... This was the introduction from Matheson to the Twilight Zone. So that's why that's on here. So that's season one. It was very successful. And in fact, I do want to point out that all 36 episodes, all but one, was written by either Rod Serling, Matheson, or Beaumont. There was only one episode, The Chaser, that was written by someone other than the big three. And that was written by Robert Presnell Jr. Season two, here we go, season two. The show was so successful, it was renewed for a second season. Great, 29 episodes. There were actually two episodes slated in season two that did not air in season two, they aired in season three instead. That would be The Grave, and that would also be, what was the other one? Yep, Nothing in the Dark. So those would air in season three. There was also an episode in season two, A Most Unusual Camera, that was supposed to air in season one, but aired in season two instead. So a little bit of things going on there. I want to talk about this one here first. This was King Nine Will Not Return. This was written by Rod Serling. The Airplane, so it takes place, it's almost sort of like Where Is Everybody, the season one episode, in that there's this man in the desert by a crashed airplane. Thinking, why am I alone? What's going on? Turns out, what happened is he was the captain of that airplane, and he didn't actually go on the final flight of that airplane, and that plane went down, and his crew, they all passed away in that crash, and he lived with the guilt of not being on that plane. He's having these hallucinations and flashbacks, and he's actually in a hospital, and at the end of the episode, there's sand in his shoe. So going back to where is everybody? When Rod Serling inserted that theater ticket into the pocket, he's doing that actually in the episode here. He's having sand in the shoe to give it sort of that supernatural element. But what I want to talk about the plane here, they took a plane and they junked it. They trashed it to make it look like a downed airplane. According to some sources, which I have read, they reconstructed the plane and it was able to fly again, which is an amazement if you actually watch the episode. I didn't think it was an actual plane. I thought it was some bunch of prop. It's actually a plane that was wrecked but then repaired to fly again. That's pretty cool. Rod Serling really had an affinity for airplane episodes because his brother was a pilot. This episode here, season 2 episode, Odyssey of Flight 33, his brother was on as a consultant to make sure they got the dialogue and the cockpit actions correct, and it was really well done. This episode here, we all know this one? Yes, we do. It was originally titled Private World of Darkness. The actual episode title is Eye of the Beholder. It was titled Private World of Darkness because Eye of the Beholder was... There was a copyright claim out on it. Someone was writing children's books with that title. Or no, it was a children's video, promotional video, educational video. And there was a copyright claim. So the network, okay, find a new title. Fine. Private World of Darkness. The claim was settled. So if you were to watch it nowadays in syndication, Eye of the Beholder is what appears as the title. What's also interesting here is Donna Douglas from Beverly Hillbillies is actually the person who's supposedly very ugly. And throughout the entire episode, her voice is dubbed over because it's in bandages, someone else doing her voice. She has one line when her face is not bandaged. They originally wanted to dub that over as well for consistency. But Donna Douglas studied the voiceover woman so well. She got her cadence down. She got her inflection down. She was able to really mimic her cadence and tone so well. That it's, okay, yep, you can speak that. Go ahead and speak that line. It sounds just fine. So... credit to her, I say. And that was a Rod Serling episode. I want to talk about this one now, The Invaders. This is a Matheson episode. Matheson wrote this episode. Rod Serling said he had two episodes that were his favorite episodes. One was Time Enough at Last, with Henry Bemis and his glasses broke. The second was this one, The Invaders, starring Agnes Moorehead, which you may know from Bewitched. The one comment Rod Serling has to say about this episode that's negative is that the special effects of the time, and so think about it, this is the 1960s. They had to use for the alien for the spacemen wind-up toys. You can see the wind-up right here. He would have preferred not to do that, but given the limitations of the time, that's what he used. That's fine. The spacemen have one line spoken by the director. The director dubs in the line at the end of this episode, which means no actors speak in this episode at all. For the half hour episode, there is no dialogue, no words, nothing, except for the dubbed in dialogue by the director speaking as one of the spacemen. This is also the only episode where Rod Serling appears on screen in the beginning with another character present. I would argue that there's one other episode in season 2, Nervous Man in a $4 Room, but that's just clever camera play where they show this room in the background with him standing above it. It's actually really neat. So I would argue there's two, but he is definitely in the same frame and the same shot as Agnes Moorehead when he gives his introduction for this particular episode. This episode here. This episode, classic episode. The Howling Man. This is a Charles Beaumont episode. Charles Beaumont did not want the ending to go the way it went when it was filmed and shot. Essentially, there's a prisoner in a monastery who is howling, and he is the devil, and he convinces this man to let him out, and he does. And once he is let out, he transforms into the devil. So, oh, how could I be so stupid? I saw him, but I didn't recognize him. The transformation scene is not what Charles Beaumont originally wanted. It was not how it was written. What he wanted was that as the man was climbing out the window, you would see sort of a hoof for his foot, and you can infer, oh, he is the devil. Instead, they went with this dramatic transformation scene, which is really, really cool, but for time constraints and syndication, it kind of gets edited out, which is really, really unfortunate in my mind. That's one thing that happens. You'll notice that as they air in syndication more and more and more, there are more edits because they want to fit in more commercials for more sponsors, which is the one thing that Rod Serling wasn't a fan of, which I'm going to get into that. Trust me. Trust me. Okay. I want to talk about this one now, The Silence. Great Rod Serling episode. I chose this scene purposefully because I want to talk about one thing that happened here. So this particular actor, I'm going to butcher his name and I apologize, Franco Tone. Anyone know how to... Okay, so he filmed on the first day in parlor scene. Great. That night, he supposedly got into a bar fight and the whole left side of his face was scuffed up and scratched and it would... He comes in for filming the next day to finish the show. I'm like, we can't film you like this. So what they did, they only filmed half his face. All the scenes he was in on that second day of filming, they filmed half of his face. So if you watch that episode and you can see him, why are they only showing half his face? It's not even, if I didn't point it out or if I didn't read about it, I would never have known. It's completely unnoticeable. It's really, really well done. But next time you see that episode, take a look. You'll see there are scenes where only half his face is shown. That's the reason, that they could not show the scuffed up face. Now, I did mention Twilight Zone was a little expensive to film given the different sets and all that going on. So in season two, a decision was made that 6 episodes were going to be filmed on videotape instead of film. This is one of them, Night of the Meek, an actual real Christmas episode. That's actually Art Carney playing Santa Claus. He plays on a department store Santa, and he really wants to help people, and he finds that Santa's actual bag, and he can give people gifts. Everyone thinks he's stealing stuff, so it's a big... He eventually gets to become Santa for the night, or maybe even longer. It's actually a really, really nice story. And Rod Serling, at the end of it, and saying, this has been the Twilight Zone, or ending with the Twilight Zone, he finishes with Merry Christmas to all, which is, you know, he's really laying into the Christmas theme. But this is one of 6 episodes. The other 5 episodes that were shot on video were 22, sort of like a final destination, where a woman has a dream about going to the morgue, and then she goes on an airplane, she sees that same woman, she runs away, and the plane explodes. The whole truth about a used car salesman who, whenever he's near this one particular car, he has to tell the truth, which does not end well for him in many situations. Long Distance Call, starring Billy Mummy, child like Billy Mummy, where his grandmother's communicating to him from beyond the grave. Let's see, what other ones? Lateness of the Hour, where a woman is in a house full of robots that were built by her father, and she wanted to get sick of all the robots. Like, ugh, I just want to live a normal life. I'm tired of the robot. Well, she was a robot as well. So careful what you wish for, I guess. Exactly. And so that was eventually scrapped because the savings that they did on the recording on videotape it wasn't worth it, giving the obvious visual, how do I want to word this? You watch these episodes and you can say, why is this one? Oh, Static was also, Static was the 6th one, by the way, a Charles Beaumont story about a man who finds his old radio and he's able to go back in time to when he was younger and not a crotchety old man as he is depicted in the actual episode. So you watch these episodes and you say, there's something visually off about them. Something doesn't look right. It's because they were shot on videotape instead of film. And it was decided that the cost saving did not offset the visual negative effects. And specifically in episode 22, when they show the plane explosion, they were very limited on the effects they could do, even in the 1960s. Basically, they had a cardboard model they had to light on fire that served as the explosion. It was really very cheesy, even by 1960 standards go. So they scrapped that and went back to film. And with that, season 2 comes to a close. But the season 3 is actually pretty cool. Because season 3 right here, he really brings in some other writers. And so instead of the big 3 doing most, this one right here, this opened season 3. Montgomery Pittman, the director, actually wrote this episode. This is Charles Bronson, and this right here is a pre-Bewitched Elizabeth Montgomery. It's actually a really, really neat story. They actually filmed this on a rundown lot. They didn't have to build anything. The lot was so run down, they said, yep, we're going to film right here, because they wanted a rundown city in the background, and they found it. These two episodes right here are George Clayton Johnson episodes. So this is not Matson, this is not Beaumont, this is not Serling. This is A Game of Pool with Jack Klugman and Jonathan Winter. And this right here is Robert Redford. He was in Nothing in the Dark. Yep, he played Mr. Death, coming to get this woman, who is a shut-in because she's afraid Mr. Death is going to come get her. So he befriends her and says, I'm not a bad guy. It's actually really well done. The thing about this episode is George Clayton Johnson did not write the ending originally as it aired. Rod Serling went up to him and said, I want to change the ending. I want to change to this. George Clayton Johnson was opposed to it, but they had a little chat. He relented. Basically, Jack Klugman plays a pool hawk. He is big into pool. He loves it. That's his life. He wants to be the very best. Jonathan Winter's character, Fats Brown, is the undisputed best pool player to have ever graced the pool alleys. Fats Brown is not living, so you can't actually play Fats Brown. You can only be compared to him. But in classic Twilight Zone fashion, you actually can play the legend if the legend deems you worthy. In George Clayton Johnson's story, Fats Brown wins. In the episode, yeah, Klugman wins. You know, I mean, I'm sure the original ending is good. I mean, George Clayton Johnson got a bunch of actors together later on, and he shot it the way he wrote it. He liked it. I have no doubt that was a good ending. George Clayton Johnson's a good author. That's going to come up a little bit later in a season 5 episode, and it doesn't end the same. The relationship does not end the same way. I want to talk about, oh yes, this one right here. This one right here, the episode's called 4 O'Clock. Theodore Bickel plays a man. Basically, he's like a 1960s troll. He calls people up. Hey, so-and-so said this. You got to fire him. I'm going to call back in a week if he's not fired, and I'm going to try to have you fired for not firing him. He's an absolute troll. He gets his comeuppance at the end, don't worry. But the reason I want to point this out is there's a parrot here. This parrot was the pet of Rod Serling's children at the time. So it's in the episode. I just think that's a really neat tidbit. This one right here, I Sing the Body Electric, was written a story by Ray Bradbury of the same title. This story was problematic for a few reasons. One, Rod Serling really didn't feel that Ray Bradbury's work translated well to television. He had great respect for Ray Bradbury, immense respect. He wanted deeply to do a Ray Bradbury story for years. He finally got one. But elements just didn't work out. It had to be rewritten a few times. They had to switch directors because the visions weren't lining up. And Ray Bradbury was not pleased because, in his words, the most pivotal scene was cut from the episode. I don't know what scene that was. I'm sure I could figure it out if I go back and read the original story and compare with the episode. But it just didn't work, and Ray Bradbury wanted nothing to do with Twilight Zone after that, which was, you know, unfortunate because he was one of the leading sci-fi minds at the time, not really wanting to do with the show. So, but that's the way it is. And then there's this episode. Anybody recognize this person? I know it's far away. That's Carol Burnett. Carol Burnett. This was the only episode, the name is Cavender is Coming, that originally had a laugh track to it. It was supposed to be a spin-off where this bumbling guardian angel was going to help Carol Burnett's character sort of become better in life. But she realized at the end of the episode, she liked her life the way it was. She didn't need all the money and fame and fortune that this guardian angel could bring to her. Rod Serling must have had an affinity to this kind of a story because in season 1, he wrote exactly the same story, except not with Carol Burnett. It was, and not no laugh track. It was exactly the same story with two different actors, same moral, basically the same plot throughout. It was also designed to be a spinoff. And it was called Mr. Beavis. And neither spinoff was taken up. Oh well, I mean, he tried twice. Maybe a third time would have been the charm. I don't know, but he only tried twice. And with that, season 3 came to a close. The show actually was canceled after this. Not because of anything else, but because a sponsor was late to pick it up in the next round of renewal, whatever. So because they didn't have a sponsor, oh no, we the network heads, oh, we can't back this expensive show. Oh no, no sponsor, what are we going to do? So it was canceled. And the executive producers moved on to other things. Rod Serling got a teaching job, and that was it. That was the end of Twilight Zone. But the show that replaced it didn't do so well in ratings and was canceled at the end of 1962. And they needed a show to fill in for it as a mid-season replacement. And The Twilight Zone was chosen for that. Now, it had to go from a half-hour show to an hour-long show. The format had to change. The day had to change. It had to switch to a Thursday night to fill in for that time slot. But Twilight Zone was renewed. And with that came the hour-long episodes, which some have criticized being a little too padded. Okay, fine. But this episode right here, In His Image, was a Charles Beaumont episode that Rod Serling had wanted to do for years. he couldn't do it because there was so much going on, he couldn't make it fit into the half-hour time slot. But fortunately, now that it's expanded to a one-hour time slot, it could actually work. And it works really well. Charles Beaumont does a good job. I want to go to this episode. This is also a Charles Beaumont episode. I know none of you will recognize this man. I'm going to tell you his name, and you may not know his name either. This is Robert McCord. Anybody know him? Okay. He is credited with the most appearances in the Twilight Zone episode. Depending which source you read, he is either in at least 90, he could be in over 100. His credits include Man on Street, Man in Crowd, Man on Step, Man with Apple. And here he actually plays a... So these are wax figures. This is Burke and... That's Jack, supposed to be Jack the Ripper. This is Burke and Hare, the Scottish serial killers who smothered their victims. He actually has some really legit screen time here. He's not playing an extra. So that's why it's hard to pin down just exactly how many episodes he's in, because you have to really watch every single background person to really see. But he's at least 90. He could be in over 100. It's really hard to pin that number down. But Robert McCord gets credit for that. If you want to talk about just leading actors, people who've held lead roles, there are two actors tied for the most lead roles in Twilight Zone. That would be Jack Klugman and Burgess Meredith. We all know those names? Yeah. I see. We have a Burgess Meredith fan in the back. Excellent. Yep. They're in four episodes each. So Jack Klugman was in a season one episode, Passage for Trumpet. He was in a season three episode, Game of Pool, which we talked about. He was in a season four episode, Death Ship. And he was in a season five episode, In Praise of Pip, which I'm going to get to shortly. Burgess Meredith, time enough at last. His glasses broke. We all know that one. He was also in two season two episodes. That was Mr. Dingle the Strong and The Obsolete Man. We are definitely covering The Obsolete Man. So I'm just spoiler warning, Obsolete Man's coming up. He was also in The Printer's Devil. And that rounds out his four, which was a season four episode. But here, this episode, right here, Robin, this is very well done. So it's basically a curator at a museum who wants to take care of his wax figurines. And the museum is closing down. So he takes his wax figurines home with him. And he spends like so much money on ridiculous air conditioning bills. And people start dying. And the wax figurines are serial killers. And so he doesn't know what's going on. It turns out he is the serial killer. The museum curator is the serial killer. Who would have ever seen that come? But that's the story there. This one here. On Thursday, We Leave for Home. Rod Serling has called this one of probably, he said it is, quote, probably the finest one-hour episode that was done. One of the finest in the season. So I have that on here. Actually, we all know the movie Shawshank Redemption. Brooks is the main character in this particular episode. So what more? I want to go to this episode here, No Time Like the Past. This episode was the most expensive episode to film in the entire series. I have numbers for this one. It cost $160,000 to film at the time. In today's money, that's a little over $1.6 million for the episode. Most other episodes, the cheapest ones, would come at around $40,000 to $60,000. So you're talking about $400,000, $600,000 in today's money. This one came in at a lot higher than that. Now, it was an hour-long episode, and the sources I've read can't really pinpoint one reason or another why it came in so high. So I can't tell you why it came in so high. I can only tell you that it did. And now I want to talk about this episode. This is Passage on the Lady Anne. This was the last episode that Charles Beaumont wrote for the series. He is credited with three other season five episodes, Living Doll, Queen of the Nile, and number 12 Looks Just Like You. But those were ghostwritten. And the reason I want to talk about Charles Beaumont here is in his mid-30s, he developed early-onset dementia, and his mental facilities rapidly declined and was unable to produce scripts anymore, and he died before he even reached the age of 40. So, yes, it was very rapid. And looking back on some of the scripts that he wrote, Static, about being young again, Passage on the Lady Anne, which talks about a crew of older people who are aware their time is coming, they set sail on the ship, and there are other episodes too, Person to Person Unknown, where a gentleman wakes up and does not recognize some would think maybe he's drawing inspiration for a script from what he's going through personally. I can't confirm that theory. It's only a theory. He's not here to confirm it. He'll be the only person to confirm it. But some have speculated that that's the case. And with that, Season four. Oh, sorry. I have to talk about this one with Burt Reynolds here. This closed season four, all right? I have to talk about this episode for no other reason than what has happened to it. You watch the episode, it's an okay episode. A gentleman who's a streetcar conductor wants to write scripts for TV. He is a terrible writer. It is established. He walks in, I got a script here. Everyone just rolls their eyes, oh, this guy again. So what he does, he goes and buys a book from Black Magic Shop, sold to him by the same actress who played The Wicked Witch of the West. She plays a bookstore dealer. Yep. Anyway, he conjures William Shakespeare to write this script for him, who is, if you don't have William Shakespeare as your top author of all time, he's probably in the top three. So Rod Serling chose undisputably the top writer ever to have write the script for this episode. And what happens? It goes through massive, massive edits because of sponsorships and networks. There's one scene in the table read that he's reading the script. Like, oh, this is such archaic language. And I can't do it justice. It's written in prose like William Shakespeare would. And the line is, oh, she's crying, shedding tears as if, you know, an onion were responsible or something like that. And they go, onion? Sponsorship conflict. We don't sell it. So they change it from onion to turnip. So she sheds tears as if a turnip were responsible. You know, but here's the kicker. Here's the kicker. You watch that episode in syndication, that whole scene is completely edited out so that more commercials can be put in. So that, for me, that scene was the point of this episode. And that scene is edited out so more commercials can be shown. There's another point to the episode in which Burt Reynolds plays this just actor who is just so full of himself and just knows everything about acting. You can't possibly give him direction because he knows it all and he's just the greatest. He actually ends up getting knocked out by William Shakespeare because William Shakespeare said, what happened to this? What happened to that? Oh, no, we changed that. Networks didn't like that. Sponsors didn't like, we didn't like. And so William Shakespeare is looking at his script, which he poured his heart and soul into, and nothing about it is what he wrote. And he just knocks Burt Reynolds out because he's tired of his attitude. It's one of those, don't shoot the messenger, but in this case, the messenger was portrayed to be a real jerk. So he kind of punched the messenger instead. So I have to talk about that episode because I have no doubt in my mind Rod Serling wrote that episode for one reason or two. He wrote it against censorship from sponsors and networks. And what happens? It gets edited because of sponsors. So you know what? What can you do? And we go to season five. Season five kicks off with a praise of Pip. Jack Klugman right there. Billy Mummer right there. Rod Serling wrote this episode. Now look at the year. 1963. Jack Klugman gets news that his son has been wounded during a war. And he says on screen, I can't believe, what a senseless war. So this is a little bit unheard of at the time. You're making commentary on a TV show about a war, forget a war, a current event, and taking a stance on it. So times have changed a little bit since pre-Twilight Zone days. Rod Serling's allowed to do this. Which is important. Right here, we all know this one. The guy on the wing, you know, the one on the plane. This was a Mattson story. Mattson wrote this story. And what I think is interesting is Rod Serling wanted to play a prank on Mattson. All right, so they were going on an airplane ride somewhere once, and he had it rigged up that like a dummy or a cardboard cutout of the Gremlin was on the wing, and he had Mattson sit on the window. Hey, could you look out the window? But the wind blew before takeoff and it fell over, so Mattson looks out the window and there's nothing there. He's like, oh. So that would have been awesome if that actually worked out. That would have been awesome. This one here, I want to talk about. It's a short drink from a certain fountain. So when Twilight Zone was sold into syndication, there were five episodes that were not part of the original syndication package. One was from season four, Miniature. One was this one, A Short Drink from a Certain Fountain. The Sounds and Silences from season five. All three of those were due to copyright issues. Miniature was a Beaumont episode. Quick Drink from a Certain Fountain, Rod Serling wrote this one. And Sounds and Silences. People claimed, and there was a copyright that, oh, you stole my idea for this. And so it goes through, you know, courts and all that, and it was eventually settled. It was eventually part of the syndication package, fine. But originally, that was not settled. It was not part of syndication. The other two were pulled from syndication because they were pulled. The first one was An Occurrence at Owl Creek, which was They got the rights from the Cannes Film Festival to show it as part of Twilight Zone in an effort to cut costs. Very good episode, but they only had the right to show it twice for the original airing, and when they aired it twice, that was it. That somehow was resolved because it airs in syndication now. The other one was The Encounter, starring George Takei, later known to go on from Star Trek, and for pushback for racial overtones or undertones, it was pulled immediately after showing. It has been since edited and now airs in syndication, but it went a long time without airing again. It just aired. It aired in the 2015 or 2016. It was one of those New Year's marathons in 2015 or 2016, and it aired again. So it was finally. It does air in syndication. I'm sure heavily edited. I want to talk about this one. So this was a Beaumont episode, ghost written by credited to Beaumont, ghost written by him, his story, but he was not providing scripts for Twilight Zone because he was unable to write. And so season 5, with Rod Serling really essentially what he said burnt out and kind of out of ideas, Beaumont not available. A lot leaned on Matheson, but they had to call in some other writers as well. And George Clayton Johnson is completely out of the picture in season 5 because he wrote a story and it was adapted for TV, 90 Years Without Slumber. The executive producer outsourced for the script and completely rewrote it. George Clayton Johnson was so appalled that he did not want his name credited at all. He said, credit me as Johnson Smith, and I'm done with Twilight Zone. So now they don't have George Clayton Johnson write scripts anymore. Eventually, they have to market out scripts. They have someone from the production staff. Anyone have any ideas? I have an idea. Great, we'll use that as a script. It was called Caesar and Me. And actually, right here, The Dummy. See Cliff Robertson here, season 3 episode? This dummy was used in that season 5 episode, The Dummy. And this dummy is actually in a museum right now. It's in David Copperfield's museum in Las Vegas. So that's pretty cool, using 2 Twilight Zone episodes. Night Call was supposed to air originally, but JFK was assassinated, so all network programming was pulled. So this episode did not air as scheduled. It aired a little bit later. Rod Serling actually wrote a very specific episode, I Am the Night Calling Me Black, in response to hatred that he seemed the world was feeling at the time. This episode here, the name is Uncle Simon. This is Robbie the Robot. He first appeared in The Forbidden Planet, that sci-fi movie. Yeah, yeah. He made a few appearances on network TV. This is actually the first of 2 appearances he made in Twilight Zone. The other would be a Brain Center at the Whipples, in which machines take, you know, this one guy says, oh, I'm just going to replace all human workers with machines. Ha! Great, I'm saving a lot of money. And then eventually he gets replaced with machines. Oh, it's not fair, it's not fair. Well, you know, too bad. But here, Uncle Simon, American Tobacco takes over as a sponsor for season 5. At one point, Uncle Simon and eventually the robot say, I want my pipe, because he's actually brutal to her. And this woman here, her name is Barbara, says, no, I'm not going to get you a pipe. Smoking's a terrible, horrible, awful habit, tobacco. Sponsor said, no. You are not allowed to do that. They had to change it. Get me some hot chocolate. If it's not hot enough, I'll throw it on the floor. Okay, fine. Whatever. I do want to point out also that this one was directed by Richard Donner. Anyone know? Yeah, he directed Omen. The Goonies. Yep, this was the first of 5 episodes he directed. First of 6. The other 5 were Brain Center of the Whipples from Agnes Would Love, which would play really well today because it's about a computer giving this one guy dating advice, but sabotaging his dating life because she was really interested in him. Would play really, really well today. Brain Center of the Whipples from Agnes Would Love, this particular one, and let's see. Oh, The Jeopardy Room, he directed that one. So he got his start really in The Twilight Zone, which is really, really neat. And then that brings us to this episode right here, The Bewitching Pool. The last episode to air in season 5, so the last episode of Twilight Zone, written by Earl Hamner Jr., who was actually the creator and head writer for The Waltons. So a little bit of fact there. When the episode was being filmed, airplanes were flying overhead, and so they really couldn't get good, clear recordings of the actors and actresses, so they decided to dub over the little girl's voice, and they used June Foray as the voice to dub that over. Anybody know June Foray? I guarantee you've heard her voice. I guarantee you. Anybody watch Looney Tunes? Pick a female character in Looney Tunes, and you have June Foray. She also did Talkie Tina in the Twilight Zone episode Living Doll, and also Chatty Cathy, the real-life doll on which Talkie Tina was based on, was also Rocky the Flying Squirrel in Rocky and Bullwinkle. So she's very well known. She was dubbed over, so that voice was dubbed over. Now, that's a little tidbit. Now I want to talk about why we're here. Power books. Because I got to tie it in somehow. That's the first, we're going to talk about books now. So I have three episodes here. Season 2, and Season 3. I talk about information gleaned from books. And I think this is actually really cool because I just think it is. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to play the scene. I'm going to let it play out. I'll fill you in what's going on. And I'm going to talk about why I think it's important and significant, why I chose it tonight. And fortunately, I have them all set and ready to go. So here we go.
Thank you so much for the book, Henry. I am indebted.
Mr. Beechcroft, Chapter 3, that's the one on initial phenomena of intense concentration. Chapter 3,
Chapter 3. Unequivocally right. Okay. Concentration is the most underrated,
I'm going to stop that here. All right, so basically what's going on here is, let's see. Whoops. That's what's going on there. Shelley Berman is playing this character. He hates people. Can't stand people. When he was cast for this episode, he's like, you want to cast me for Twilight Zone? I'm a comedian. And the episode he watched was the Invaders. He's like, you know, with Agnes Moorehead. He's like, I'm not ready for this. Like, Rod, trust me, you'll be fine. He hates people. To the point where his coworkers know he hates people, and this coworker gives him a book. This will help you deal with your hatred of people. What he gets from the book is he gets the power of concentration. Because it's a sci-fi episode, he can now manipulate reality at will. His landlady comes knocking on his door, you're late for rent, and he wills her away. Okay, let's pay rent anymore. He wills all the people away. And eventually he gets bored. So, you know what? I kind of miss people. But I hate people so much. But you know what? I like me. So maybe if there are people like me, I would like people. But I have news for you. If you hate people, you don't want a world full of people who hate people. So that didn't work out. That didn't work out for him. So eventually he realizes, you know, maybe it's best if I put things back the way they were. But my point is, he got the power to do this by opening a book and reading it and using the knowledge it contained. The next one. Whoops.
My son. I read this in the book.
The Encyclopedia. Horn. Christian Jr., M.D. Famous for his early work in childhood diseases, pioneer in vaccine research, born Meriden, Ohio, 1839, died Santa Barbara, California, 1914.
That's my son. That's Chris. I may be crazy. Or the world may be turned upside down, but I know that I've been put here for a reason. No reason. Thank you.
Okay. So let me tell you what's going on there. So basically, Cliff Robertson, this is the days of covered wagons, okay? And his son is heading west for new land. His son is very sick. They don't think he's going to make it. They're lacking food, they're lacking water. The rest of the people in his party, we got to turn around and head back. It's like, you know what? I'm going to head just over that rim there, maybe 100 yards or so, see if there's water, game, food, whatever. Turns out going over that rim just catapults him somehow, because it's Twilight Zone, into the future. And what I like about this is, if you watch any, I like a lot of sci-fi, if you watch any sort of sci-fi time travel, the person from the future, who the more advanced time has all the answers. Like if someone from the past goes to the future, they don't know what's going on. You know what? They're totally like in Back to the Future Part 2, when Marty, he goes to 1985 and he's just like, ah, what's going on? Like that. But someone from the future goes to the past, they have all the answers. They know exactly what's going on. Again, in Back to the Future, who's president? Ronald Reagan. What are you talking about? You know. So here, this is kind of flipped on its head a little bit. Cliff Robertson goes to the future. And people think he's crazy because what year is it? Oh, it's the 1800. However, he opens the book, the encyclopedia, all right? And he reads about his son. Suddenly, he has the answers, okay? The time traveler into the future, we just flip that trope right on his head. The book gives him all the answers. Now he knows what he was sent there for. He was wounded because he actually got hit by a car or truck immediately upon arrival. And so he gets penicillin. What's this? It's penicillin. It'll make you feel better. Wait a minute. This can make you feel better. My son's very sick. I need to bring this to my son. He finds out his son lives, goes on to become a really well-known doctor in the field of for children. So that's his purpose. That's why he's there. And how does he know this? Because he opened a book. The next one is a scene I'm sure you may all know. It's one of the more famous and well-known in the series.
This is flight number 914 from Earth to our planet. We will be taking off in 3 minutes.
Mr. Chambers, don't get on that ship. The rest of the book, To Serve Man, it's a cookbook.
For those who don't know that's a very well-known iconic episode. But really what's going on there is these aliens show up, played by Richard Kiel of Jaws, of James Bond. But Richard Kiel does not provide the voice because he didn't get there in time to learn the lines. So it's like, don't worry, we'll dub the lines in. We just need someone really tall to play the part of these aliens. So you can do whatever you want. You need to learn the lines. Fine. They show up. They say, we're going to help you out, Earthlings, because we're here to help. Do nothing but help. And they leave a book. And they have to decipher the book. They've only deciphered the title. It's To Serve Man. Wow. And everyone's really excited. To Serve Man. They're really here to help us out. That's awesome. And war has ended. Deserts turn into just gardens. Every country has a giant force field. There's no, like, everything is at total peace. Okay. You guys want to come visit our planet? Yeah, sure. Sounds great. So like, people go on vacation to their planet. They love it so much, they never come back. It's great. It turns out in the climax, To Serve Man is not a book about helping humanity. It's actually a cookbook. But how, now I want to get back to, how did we find out, how did she find out that the alien's true intentions were not altruistic and benevolent? How did she find out they were malevolent? She found it in a book. I want to play this one more time. This scene kills me. So there's an attendant. It's a short scene, so I'm going to do it. Just I'm going to ruin this episode for you forever, but I'm going to play it. I don't care. There's an attendant by the airplane. And I want you to watch the attendant, okay? As it's announced, it's a cookbook. I want you to watch his face expression and watch what he does, okay? And then I want you to think the phrase, that's above my pay grade. Just keep that in mind. Keep that in mind.
This is flight number 914 from Earth to our planet. We will be taking off in 3 minutes.
Mr. Chambers.
There he is right there with a hat. Watch him.
Chambers.
That is above my pay grade. Okay, so that, yeah. That makes me laugh every time. It shouldn't, because it's a very serious scene. I'm sorry for ruining that for you forever, but I had to point that out. Okay. Now, from current slide. Okay, so power books, very powerful. Roll libraries. I have to talk about The Obsolete Man. I know for our Burgess Meredith fan. Yep, thank you. This is a Burgess Meredith episode. This was the last episode of season two, and many regard this as one of Twilight Zone's finest episodes. This dialogue here is between Burgess Meredith and the chancellor of this futuristic society, played by Fritz Weaver. You persist in calling yourself a librarian. He said, yes, that is correct, sir. A librarian having to do with books. And he says it so disdainfully, with books, just so disdainfully. I want to bring us back to a point I made earlier in the talk about how the society that when you get to a certain age and you're deemed unfit, you're nixed, and the network put a stop to that. Rod Serling reworked this. It's no longer when you're deemed obsolete, and that could be any number of things. In this particular case, being a librarian is obsolete because in this society, there are no more books. And I want to play the exchange of the chancellor and the librarian, the proud librarian, by the way, who does not back down when questioned about being a librarian, knowing that admitting that he is a librarian is signing his death certificate. So I'm going to play you the exchange.
Human being, you're a librarian, Mr. Wordsworth. You're a dealer in books and 2 cent fines and pamphlets and closed stacks on the musty insides of a language factory that spews out meaningless words on an assembly line. Words, Mr. Wordsworth, that have no substance and no dimension, like air, like the wind. Like a vacuum that you make believe has an existence by sprinkling index numbers on little cards. I don't care. I tell you, I don't care. I'm a human being. I exist.
If I speak one thought aloud, that thought lives. Even after I'm shoveled to my grave. Okay. So. Basically, what the chancellor is saying is that you're a librarian, you're obsolete because you deal with books. Well, I got news for you. Libraries are more than books. I know y'all didn't come here to hear that because, I mean, you all know that. But libraries are more than books, especially our library. I mean, come on. I mean, closed stacks, well, maybe they're closed now. But when we get in that new library, we're going to have great open stacks. So come back in a year. We'll hook you up. 2 cent fines, we're fine free. So he's not talking about the Dighton Library. But the point is, we have a lot more in libraries than books. And I know I talked in my previous slide about power in books, but my next slide, I want to talk about knowledge in general and how it's not just in books, it's everywhere, and you can find knowledge in libraries. So, right here. Okay. What's that?
You should remind us how it ended.
I will remind you. So, because he does not recant on being a librarian and is deemed obsolete, he is sentenced to death by execution. He gets to choose the manner in which he is executed, and he chooses a bomb to go off in his apartment. He invites the chancellor to have a little chat, and when the chancellor arrives, he locks the door. He's also having it televised. And so the chancellor and Mr. Wordsworth are there in the apartment knowing that a bomb will go off at X amount of time. And the chancellor breaks down. He can't handle it. He can't handle it. He's like, in the name of God, let me out, which is a no-no, because in this state, religion is completely, believing in religion is obsolete. And so the bomb goes off. Mr. Wordsworth has perished. The chancellor goes back to work thinking business as usual. He walks in and is immediately subject to the tribunal. You are obsolete. How do you defend yourself? Well, no, I'm not obsolete. It's like, yes, you are. And he is deemed to be executed. Now, the part, little tidbit, is the editor in splicing the episode together did not splice it the way the director wanted. It was completely different. They wanted the people to stand around him, and then as they enveloped him, that's when it would end. It was not cut that way. They enveloped him, he runs out, he pleads and begs, they grab him and drag him over the table, and that's how it ends. So it wasn't cut the way they wanted, but it was done that way anyway. And in the ending narration, Rod Serling appears on screen in the ending narration, one of only three times he does this. And the ending narration that was aired was not his original ending narration. He actually had a much longer one that was cut for time. And because that was cut way early on in the days, we will never see that. It was left on the cutting room floor. So basically, The Chancellor is obsolete for holding these views that certain people are obsolete, especially those librarians. Librarians aren't obsolete. Now I want to talk about knowledge in general, okay? And I want to start with this Charles Beaumont episode. Long live Walter Jameson.
What have you got there?
I apologize, this is the best quality I could find.
It was taken by a fellow named Matthew Brady during the time of the Civil War.
Well, what is it? You look as though you'd seen a ghost.
Was your grandfather in the Civil War by any chance?
No.
That picture was taken almost 100 years ago. You shouldn't have kept that ring, you know. It's a dead giveaway.
No, he's got a sense of humor about it. So what's going on there? Is that gentleman's a history teacher, and he brings in documents, and he can really tell history as if he were actually there, because he was. He is basically immortal. So in order to find him out and figure out that he was immortal, what did he do? He opened a book, and he used the information within it from a photograph, but information nonetheless to figure him out. And now he was actually going to marry his daughter, and he didn't want that because you're not going to change and you're going to actually leave. So it's a whole thing. He's not immortal. He's just eternally young. He's eventually shot and killed, and he ages. It's a really, really well-done scene, the way he ages. It kind of gives you chills. But I think back again to Charles Beaumont. This was a Charles Beaumont episode, and I think about being young and all, and what he was dealing with. Now I want to talk about this Richard Lang episode, also a Charles Beaumont episode. Person or persons unknown, which a fact of trivia you cannot find anywhere. This was the very first episode of Twilight Zone I ever saw in my life. You can only find that here.
Sam, I think I may have found that little detail they overlooked.
What's the number again?
6708777.
You sure?
Positive. Look, the photographer gave me a slip and I lost it, but I remember that number because of the 47s.
Maybe your wife's got it.
My wife doesn't even know the picture was taken. I was going to surprise her.
You sure it was on the 14th?
Yes, on a Sunday. We were at the zoo.
Oh, I'm sorry, but... Hey, wait a minute. Is that a 7 or a 1?
7.
Well, that it?
Yes. Yes, that's it.
Are you okay, mister?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay, that'd be $1.75. Hey, wait a minute, you owe me money.
Well, doctor, what brings you here?
I might ask you the same question. If you really wanted to elude us, you know, you shouldn't have left that stolen car downstairs.
This man owes me money.
Oh.
$1.81, to be exact, and you know what for, doctor? Proof that I'm not crazy. I told you they couldn't think of everything, and I was right.
I suppose you found a signature or a receipt or...
Oh, but that wouldn't be proof, would it, doctor? Because I could have signed a signature any time.
Right.
Or had a card printed up or faked a driver's license. Nice. But what about a photograph, doctor? What about a photograph of me holding hands with a girl who claims she never laid eyes on me before this morning? How would you explain that? Take it out and look at it, and then think up some answers. Well...
So I'm just going to talk about real quick, set the stage there. What happens is he wakes up and his wife doesn't recognize him. He's like, oh, okay, this is actually a little risque at the time because there were two episodes in Twilight Zone that pictured a husband and a wife sharing the same bed together. Ooh, whoa. In both episodes, one is under the covers, one is on top of the covers. So he wakes up, she's in her pajamas under the covers. He is fully clothed on top of the covers. Okay, fine. The other episode, season 5 episode, Stop Over in a Quiet Town, both are fully clothed, and they're on so they got around it, but they did show them in two. She doesn't recognize him. It's like, I'm going to work. He goes to work. Like, who are you? You don't work here. It's like, what are you talking about? I've worked here for however many years. Doesn't recognize him. He eventually gets sent to a mental facility to deal with these issues he's obviously dealing with. And he breaks out because he knows he is sane. And he has to go to a piece. He has to find some knowledge that exists that he can prove he's not insane. He thinks he's found the knowledge on a photograph, but he doesn't. But it's all a dream. And he wakes up, and he's in his house. Everything's fine. And then his wife shows up, his real wife, and he doesn't recognize. He's like, who the heck are you? So that's the twist ending, which is actually kind of cool. But I wanted to share that for the photograph, that knowledge. All right, I got this one with Keenan Wynn. This is actually really cool because this marked Rod Serling's first on-screen appearance. I want to play this one real quick. We're almost there.
We hope you enjoyed tonight's romantic story on the Twilight Zone. At the same time, we want you to realize that it was, of course, purely fictional. In real life, such ridiculous nonsense could never...
Rod! You mean you shouldn't say such things as nonsense and ridiculous?
Well, that's the way it goes.
That's the way it goes. So what's going on there? What happens is, so the story goes, Keenan Wynn's character, he's a writer, and so he dictates his characters onto a recorder. And when that character is on the recorder, they literally come to life. So I'm using this as sort of a metaphor for you have a piece of knowledge, in this case, a piece of film, but it could be anything. But when that piece of knowledge, in this case, a film, is thrown into and destroyed, whatever knowledge is on that is gone forever. And the physical embodiment works out. It works that way because it's established in the episode that his wife he created, and he decided she was not right for him. And that was that. He found in his recording had someone much much nicer because he forgot as a writer he didn't give her the human frailty that was necessary. So he in his recorder someone new pops up. Fine. Then Rod Serling shows up and he says, "Oh, this is ridiculous." Blah blah blah. And then the same thing happened. But I want to take the metaphor to its conclusion in that. Knowledge exists, but if the medium that knowledge is on is destroyed or gone, so is that knowledge. And then, by the way, this was Rod Serling's first on-screen appearance. It was at the end of the last episode of season one. He makes one on-screen appearance at the end of another episode, well, The Obsolete Man, and the season three episode, The Fugitive, in which he shows a picture to the audience. Following this, in every season two, three, four, and five episode, he appears in the intro to give the narrations in person. Because he was told by the network, hey, you did great. And the audience, you know, we got great ratings, good feedback, you should do it. He said, okay, fine. He listened to the network and so on and so forth. He appears. So now we just saw what happens when the medium containing knowledge is destroyed. And now Rod Serling is going to give us a bit of a warning on what happens when knowledge is destroyed. And this is the clip we're going to end on, and this will be the end of the lecture. What happens when, I'm going to turn this down because I believe this is one of the louder clips. What happens when knowledge is actually destroyed?
Why does it still stand? Why do we keep it standing?
There is an answer to the doctor's question. All the Dachaus must remain standing. The Dachaus, the Belsens, the Buchenwalds, the Auschwitzes. All of them. They must remain standing because they are a monument to a moment in time when some men decided to turn the earth into a graveyard. Into it, they shoveled all their reason, their logic, their knowledge, but worst of all, their conscience. And the moment we forget this, the moment we cease to be haunted by its remembrance, then we become the gravediggers. Something to dwell on and to remember. Not only in the Twilight Zone, but wherever men walk, God's earth.
So I think Rod Serling puts it quite eloquently. You don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it. Rod Serling, who was Jewish, obviously had strong opinions about it. If you don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it. Books, libraries contain knowledge. He's saying you must save your knowledge. Think about the scene with Keenan Wynn. When that medium is destroyed and that knowledge is gone, you can't get it back. You must retain your knowledge because it's going to inform your future. I think Rod Serling puts it eloquently. He says it perfectly. I don't want to say it any other way. That's exactly the message he's giving. And that's the message I want to leave you on. But then I have this fun slide right here, which is full of Easter eggs from all these episodes. Maybe you can point all the episodes and references that they are. I can't quite get them all, but I get most of them.